Hello everyone, welcome back to Exotic Astrology. And today I'm delighted to have Navneet Chitkara ji with us from Vyasa Astro Channel. Welcome, sir. It's very good to have you.
Hare
Hello.
Krishna, thank you so much for inviting me. It's such a pleasure all the time. And every time I come on your channel, I think I feel rejuvenated. I feel so good about everything. Thank you so much, Babaji ji.
My pleasure, sir. So today we just discussed to take the chart of a very famous personality and get some amazing insights on his journey and of course using astrology and the combinations and his life events and his dashas. So the stage is all yours, sir. Please reveal to everyone who that personality is.
Thank you so much, Babaji ji. See, it was my long wish to discuss the chart of Srila Prabhupada ji. And I have been researching for a very, very long time. I've been reading a lot of his books. One of his the most beautiful book is written by himself, the Prabhupada ji. And this is The Messenger of the Supreme Lord. This is the name of the book from Prabhupada ji. So you know what? I think it's been 2 years now that I'm researching on the events of his life and what he's done. And then I wanted to share this with the soul and all the viewers, our followers and viewers about Srila Prabhupada. And then I didn't have the courage to do it alone, So I wanted another Krishna devotee like you, right, who would be beside me when I'm doing this. That's the first thing, because to take up the chart of such personality is we don't have the capacity, to be very honest, right? And then the research work was so much that there was so much of confusion between the time of the birth, right? Because everyone knew that he was born on 1st of September, 1896, but then the problem was with the time of the birth, right? So that was the major challenge, because in the time frame of which is 3 p.m. to 4 p.m., the Lagna was changing, right? It was changing from Sagittarius to Capricorn. And you have a lot of videos on YouTube, and they are very good videos, in fact, where the time of birth has been taken around 3:30, or 3:30 quarter to 4, where the Lagna is Sagittarius, right? But then I researched, and then I found and met a few devotees, which have this information is also there on the internet, which if we can provide if somebody wants it, that it shows that the time is 4 p.m. And some of his devotees has published the articles that they have met personally. They were initiated by Srila Prabhupada ji himself. And I mean, while asking him the time of the birth, Srila Prabhupada ji has revealed it himself that he was born after the 4 p.m. Right, so those details are there on the internet as well, which we can share. So what I'll do, Babaji ji, without further discussion, I'll just show the chart, and then we can take it forward from there. And we know his achievements. I have the list of achievements, which I'll be discussing one by one. But then this is I have my heart is at 150 right now, because just because it's the chart of someone whom I admire so much personally, whom I feel has brought the biggest Krishna consciousness in the world right now, right? And what he has done, I don't think in another 400 years or 500 years we'll have someone who could do it again, right? And that too in the span of his last 10-15 years. That's the biggest thing, right? So I'll just share my screen with you, and I'll share his chart. So this is the chart, ladies and gentlemen. It is Srila Prabhupada ji, 1st September 1896, and it is 1600 hours, right? So this is the Capricorn rising, right? I know that there will be some conflicts based on this. You know, there are people who will say that it is not Capricorn, it is Sagittarius, right? I respect them because they have some information, but then we have done a kind of a time rectification here where we've taken the, you know, the events of his life, you know, and then we've done the rectification. Okay. So that's something which is very, very important. I think, sir, there's some problem here. We'll have to stop the recording. You've done it. It says time left is 9:33. Some message is coming.
Great.
All right. So we have his chart here, and it is 1st of September, 1896, and it is 1600 hours. Now, he was born in Calcutta, West Bengal, which is called Kolkata now. And this is Capricorn rising, Makar Lagana. And he was born in the Mrikshira Nakshatra Pada 2. Right? You know, the first observation, Babaji Ji, what I see here is, look at his Chandra. Right? Chandra in the Taurus, in the fifth house of the Mantra Shastra. Right? The fifth house is where the entire Mantra Shastra is. Right? Fifth house is where we have the Panchaksharis. Right? And then the Mrikshira Nakshatra. Now, you know what? This is one nakshatra, which is one of my favorite nakshatras, Babaji Ji. You know why? Because this gives you a mind where you can research, and you know, you can be like that deer that keep running in the jungle. And this jungle is that universe in which we live, right? But then the most important thing about this nakshatra, Mrikshira, was that this is also the nakshatra of Ma Parvati. You know, she was the one who was able to find, you know, her Shiva, just by finding, and then eventually she got the Shiva. Right? Now, this nakshatra, Mrikshira, you know, is one nakshatra which shows that you can be only successful in the later ages of your life. You know, like, you know, once you've crossed your 30s and maybe you're entering your 50s, that is the time when the maximum achievement, you know, comes, you know, to your life. And look at his all Yoga Karaka Grahas. Like, it is a Capricorn ascendant, so the Yoga Karaka Grahas will be obviously, you know, Venus and Mercury and Saturn, you know, and all these planets are extremely well placed. So that means he was formed in a well-off family, and he was born in a very, very spiritual family, right? You know, the family of the Vaishnava. Look at the position of the Saturn. It is Amartya Karak, exalted in the 10th house. Now, if it is made as a Sagittarius Lagna, what will happen is that Saturn would go in the Ekadash Bhava, and the Shukra and Buddha will come in the 10th house, right? Where even though Shukra is making a Neech Bhangraj Yoga here, even though it will make it there as well, but Shukra will become a Marak Graha. It is not going to become a Yog Karak. Shukra will be an extremely Marak Graha because it will be the lord of the 6th and the 11th, right? So Sagittarius is not possible here, right? So with the Capricorn, you know, Babaji, the one thing I would want to tell you here is Venus, especially in this Kali Yuga that we have, is more devotional than Jupiter, right? There could be small amount of ego which has come in the Jupiter of Kali Yuga, but there is no ego in Venus. The kind of devotion, you know, Venus can give you, Jupiter will give you that devotion, but it can bring you know, some sort of stubborn, you know, nature, like at times gurus have. But then, you know, the Venus is one guru. If you find a guru that has Venus in the ninth house, or maybe Venus in the fourth house, on the fifth house, right, that guru will be a very, very devoted guru. And I was reading that he wrote more than 7,000 letters to his devotees himself. And there's a book on it, 7,000 letters personally written to the devotees. It's unimaginable, right? This is the Venus, which looks debilitated, but it is not, because it is making a Neech Bhang Raj Yoga here. It's a Neech Bhang here. The depositor of the Venus is sitting itself in the same house, right? And on the same time, now let's see some important events of his life. You know, the beauty of his chart is seen through the events. Now, the most important thing is that you see the seventh lord in his chart is sitting in the fifth house. Now, a lot of people would, you know, misinterpret the seventh house, right? It is, say, oh, it is a Ati Marak, you know, Bhava. The lord of the seventh house is obviously a Marak planet, right? But why? Because in a very layman term, it is the house of partnership, maybe your personal partnership, or maybe your professional partnership. But according to me, what my gurus have trained me, and I thanks to Sanjay Rajji and Dr. Arjun Pai, you know, these are, you know, the people who've blessed me. You know, Babaji, the seventh house is not partnership. Seventh house is house of association and dharma. It is the dharma. If fifth house is dharma, ninth house is dharma, deha sarvo dharam, if the first house is dharma, why can't be seventh house a dharma? It is a dharma. Because when you are associated with someone, it is the dharma. Your wife, your spouse is your dharam now. Right? When you say that, oh, Krishna, the first condition to attain Krishna blessings is to surrender and make Krishna consciousness as your dharma. Right? People say, oh, you know, I have been doing 16 rounds for like 5 years or 10 years and I'm not getting anything. Maybe Krishna is not coming to me. Krishna is not blessing. Why it is not happening? I found a lot of people coming and telling me, you know, while the consultation said, you know, I've been a devotee for a long time, but my life is miserable, right? So I ask him, the first question is that, you know, Krishna is not free, neither for you nor for me, right? The first thing is that Krishna will only come and help you if you do two things. One, you follow the path of dharma. Second, you surrender. Right? Until and unless you've not surrendered, right, you will not be able to achieve anything. And this seventh house is also house of opposition. And you always surrender in front of opposition, nobody else. Right? You need someone to oppose you to surrender. So what is misery in life? Misery in life is you want something and the mother nature is opposing that thing. That's the misery. That's it. Now you surrender to that misery and now you get associated. Now this chart of Srila Prabhupada does what? He said, my association is gone where? In the fifth house. In the fifth house. And, you know, I have what? You know, see the two planets sitting here. The Mangal is in Rohini, which is the nakshatra of Chandra. And Chandra is in the nakshatra of Mrikshira, which is the nakshatra of Mangal. Right? So the two planets sitting in the fifth house is exchanging their nakshatras. You know? that's how it is happening. So what does that mean? It is making a Raj Yoga here in the fifth house, which is also called a very strong, passionate Chandra Mangal Raj Yoga.
Right.
You know, now this Chandra Mangal Raj Yoga is desire, a very, very strong desire, right? You know, what Mangal does is, Mangal wants power. Mangal say that, okay, I should reach higher no matter what. I have to fight for it. I'll fight for it. But then what is the Mangal of Srila Prabhupada doing? The Mangal of the Srila Prabhupada is fighting with the mind. You need the Chandra, the Rohini, right? And the mind is so passionate, you know, on the same time for the devotion, because for the association with that Krishna, because exalted moon is also Krishna himself, right? And the fifth house is the Mantra Shastra. This is from where, you know, he went all the way to the western part of the world and, you know, did 100, you know, centers of ISKCON around the world, the temples, and the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, right? That is the beauty. And you know what? You'll find a lot of Mrikshira people who are artists also. You'll find a lot of Mrikshira people, you know, who can play different instruments. So in one of his interviews, he was saying that he was somewhere in San Francisco and he just took his mridanga, right, and did Hare Krishna Maha Mantra for 3 hours, right, alone, single, solo. And then there were people who just gathered around him and they started singing and dancing, right? This is how the journey started, right? Everything is seen from here, right? That's the beauty, right? And you see, my Guruji used to say, Navni, the Surya and the Jupiter, no? The Surya and the Jupiter is a great combination, you know, of spirituality. Now, spirituality has nothing to do with religion. Spirituality has a lot to do with the occult science. I'll explain you how. Because when you understand the occult science, the first thing that happens is that you start considering the occult science as a guru. This is what actually the guru wants to tell you. You know, guru is someone who is just passing a message to you that, okay, this is right. This is how you should move. But once you understand all the you know, Vedas and Puranas, right, you will consider the Vedas and Puranas as your guru. This is the actual message of the guru, right? In the Sikh Dharam, this is what gurus have said. The last wordings of the guru was Guru Manyo Granth, right? So that means the Granth is your guru now because it will guide you, right? And then you see the Surya and Jupiter combination is happening in the eighth house. You know, the eighth house with Ketu, right? And I mean, Jupiter and Ketu, people say a kind of a Guru Chandal like Jupiter and Rahu. But Jupiter and Ketu, you know, what does Ketu do? You know, the biggest observation in my Jyotish career is 2 observations about Ketu, just 2. Forget about the Mokshkaraka, forget about isolation, forget about everything. First is, wherever your Ketu is sitting, wherever means wherever, right? It will make you completely fearless of the properties of that house.
Yeah.
You'll be completely fearless. Right? For an example, if you have Ketu in the 10th house, right, you will leave your corporate and you will do something else. You will be fearless. Okay, you want to take a call? Everything is going fine. You know, you're getting a good salary. You have a great corporate life. You'll just leave it. Leave it with one thought that I don't want to do it anymore. That's it. I'm done. Because it is going to make you very, very strong and revolutionary with regards to that house in which the Ketu is sitting. Because Ketu is one that breaks the rules of the society.
Okay, I see.
You know, it will break the rules of that house and can completely transforms you. You know, and Ketu is actually sitting in the house of transformation for him. And what a transformation. What a transformation. From, you know, from a medical shop, which he was running, right? The pharmaceuticals and, you know, that shop to something called Srila Prabhupada. And the kind of achievements that is done is unimaginable. Right. So if we start reading his books from today and one book every month, it will take you and me 15 years. 15 years to read his old books that he's written in only 10 years of his lifespan.
Correct.
This is what Ketu did. This is the exact meaning of the Ketu here in the 8th house. And nobody knew what he's doing. He was just writing, writing, writing. And then Sun and Jupiter were there, you know, with him in the 8th house.
Right.
Right. And you know what? There's another thing I want to tell about Saturn and his dashas. And I want to tell, you know, one important thing. He was initiated by Bhakti Nanda Saraswati Thakuraji. And he was initiated in 1932. Okay. So when you say 1932, he was exactly 36 years old at that point of time.
Correct.
And there's one observation from the experience that I have achieved from looking at charts. If you have Saturn as a Yog Karak or a Lagnesh, or a Bhagesh, or a Panchamesh, and it is exalted, right, in the Kendra, or the Trikona, or if it is in any sign, in Trik Bhavas, right, you will have a major transformation at the age of 36.
Okay.
Because that is the time when one circle of the Yogini Dasha is over.
I see. Okay.
The Yogini Dasha circle is 36. It is over at the 36. One circle. And then the another circle starts.
Okay. Right?
So in okay. First circle, the Saturn has given you all the pain and everything from the 36th year. If you have a guru in your life, Shani kya mangta hai? Shani guru mangta hai. Shani needs a guru. Right? Because Shani is that labor. Shani is wandering. You see, any satsang, you know, the first 4-5 rows will be of the VVIP people. Okay? The remaining 1,000 rows will be Saturn. Will be Shani. The people who are working hard for 10-12 hours and the best entertainment is go to satsang with the family, enjoy, dance and come back. You know, if you have 50,000 people in a satsang, a guru is telling you, you'll have only 5,000 people who are the elite, the remaining would be the Saturn.
Right.
So, isliye Shani guru mangta hai. Shani needs a guru. And if you have a guru and you've crossed the 36th year and the guru and Shani is a Yog Karak, Bhagesh, Panchamesh, Lagnesh, you will have amazing transformation and a positive transformation after the age of 36. And this is exactly what has happened with Prabhupada. At the age of 36, he was initiated. Mm-hmm. 1932, he received his initiation. And then, you know, actually he met his guru in 1922. What made him meet his guru? That's the most important thing. You know, people say, oh, Navneet, tell me, when will I meet my guru? you know, when I'll get, see, this is where he has 18 years of his Rahu Dasha, started with the Mangal Dasha, obviously Mrikshira, Janam Nakshatra, Pada too. And then you see, in 1922, it is Jupiter Mahadasha and Shani's Antra Dasha. Yeah. Right? This is in between he met his guru. And you know what? In 1932, you know, somewhere he was initiated. And the initiation has come from, again, you know, somewhere here, right? 1932 in the Mars period. Now, why Mars? Because the Mangal is the lord of his Janam Nakshatra. So it is a rebirth, another birth, Naya Janam. You understand? This is where he's getting the Naya Janam. And you know what? The 11th house is the Guru Charan.
Yes.
Guru ke jo charan hai, that is the Ikadash Bhava. And the Mangal is lord of the 11th house as well. And the 4th house, where your heart is, where your nourishment is, where your protection is.
Yes.
Guru Brahma, Guru Vishnu, Guru Devo Maheshwara, Guru Sakshat Param Brahma, Tasmai Shri Gurave Nama. This is where your guru is. Right? You know, that is why the Moksh Trikona, it starts from the 4th house. Why? Because the first reason for the Moksh Trikona is to be a clear heart. If your heart is clear, you will go to 8 and 12. Otherwise, the gates are blocked. The gates are blocked. So the first thing Guru said is, you clear your heart, I am with you. And you bow your head on the lotus feet of your Guru. And there you are. And there you are. Right? So he got initiated. He met his Guru. Right? And in 1944, he started his first magazine, which was something he really struggled and really, really did well, was Back to Godhead, right? And that was 1944. And I'll show you, you know, in 1944, see, he was in Saturn-Venus period.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, what is Saturn? Saturn for him is the Lagana. And what is Venus? Venus is his talent, the 5th house. Right? So in the Venus period, he started this. And I checked the transits. The transits were apt for him to initiate that. Right? Because it is the Dasha that will tell you about how that period will be. And it is the transit that will tell you the event. You know, transit at a given time is going to define that event for you. Right? So on the same time, when I looked at his Ashtak Varga, and you know what, Babaji, you are, I would say, I mean, I don't know how to say it, but for me, you know, looking at your videos and conversations, I think to analyze the Ashtak Varga, the Bhin Ashtak Varga, Sumudai Ashtak Varga, I think you are number one in the world. I would say that. Right? Because the events that you've predicted on your videos on Ashtak Varga, they are superb. Be it a childbirth, be it a foreign travel, be it a marriage. Right? So I want you to little bit, you know, explain on the Ashtak Varga of Srila Prabhupada. My small observations were, the Jupiter, the individual Jupiter score here, right, in the 9th house, and the score of the Chandra in the 3rd house, right? So if you can shed a little bit of light on the Ashtak Varga, of Srila Prabhupada.
Sure, thank you very much. And indeed, very amazing to see this Ashtavakra chart. Now, because we have started the discussion on Ashtavakra, it's very important that we remember something which I had spoken many times, yeah. That in YouTube, this is flooded. You know, any house which has 28 or more points is good.
Good.
And any house that has below that, that house is spoiled, it's damaged, it's ruined, okay? So nothing like that. So now you may say, we are discussing a chart of a spiritual personality. So you would first of all give your eyes on the ninth house, most of the people.
Yeah.
And then you would see, 17 points, you know, what is this? Maybe Ashtavakra doesn't work, or maybe this person is not a genuine sadhu or something like this. Where are maximum points? You know, it's in the sixth house. Maybe he's employed or something like this, you know, he's doing a job maybe. So that's where you go wrong, you see. So that's not how we judge. So we have to understand that now Ashtavakra can represent so many different things, okay? So if something is below 28, it doesn't mean that that house will not function, okay?
Yeah.
So if you can go to the scores, if you go, then Virgo is number 6. So here in this chart, in the screen, wherever you are seeing sign 6, that's the ninth house, because that's the sign, not the house, okay?
Yes.
So here 6 is representing the ninth house. So here, if you see, no, Jupiter is like giving 6 points there, okay? And Jupiter, although he has the highest number of points, so he generally allocates a lot of points, right? His point contributions are generally very high.
Yeah.
But here, if you see, he has contributed 6 here, which is quite significant, even if you consider Jupiter, because considering 6 is a very big number for Jupiter.
Yes. Yes.
So Jupiter for Capricorn, if you see, he's Lord of the third house, and he's also the Lord of the 12th house, right?
Yeah.
So, if you see the instruction which Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur had given, his Diksha Guru had given to Srila Prabhupada, he gave 2 instructions. That first is, whenever you get money, print books.
Yes.
And second, that was the second. The first instruction, yeah, when he went to Ultadanga Junction with his friend Naren to meet Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur.
Yeah.
When he paid obeisances and when he was getting up, you know, he said, you are a young gentleman. Why don't you take the message of Lord Chaitanya, which is, you know, Krishna consciousness, to the West? And why don't you preach it in English language? Okay.
Yeah. The third house and the 12th house.
Yeah. And second time, when he met him after a long time, he gave another instruction, as I said before, that whenever you get money, print books, right?
Yes.
So you will see, Jupiter is giving 6 points, right? So that's the thing about astrology. Like, we may see all these placements, but we really have to understand what does it mean in the horoscope, in the real life, okay? It's not just some points. So he has given 5, he has given 6. It's not like that, right?
Yeah.
So if Jupiter has given 6 points and it's the highest, it's almost more than 1/3 of the total points, you see.
Yeah.
So it means this will be something which the guru would really want this person to do, okay? Because that's the ninth house. Ninth house is the house of the guru. So one is the third house. He's Jupiter is the third lord. So
yes,
whenever you get money, print books, right?
Yes.
Now write, print, or whatever you say. And maybe if he was alive today, it would be YouTube maybe.
Yeah.
And then, of course, 12th house is going abroad, foreign land, something to do with cultures that are drastically different from ours, you know, like the language, the food, and the clothing, basically, right? So that's how we see that he went to the West. And if you further open that chart, if you go to his, So if you see his third house, it has 34 points. But if you go and see what's happening in the third house, you will see Here moon, again here in this chart, moon you see is contributing like, you know, 8 points, okay? So third house is what? Third house is the house of writing. We are all aware of that. So
yeah,
third, so that means moon is like, it's like saying moon will have a very strong say, right?
Yeah.
So moon represents what? It represents trying to connect to God emotionally.
Yeah.
And if you read the Bhagavad Gita also, so Bhagavad Gita talks of spirituality at different levels, right?
Yeah.
So first of all, it talks of Karma Yoga, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Then Karma Yoga is there. So Karma Yoga talks, okay, do whatever you are doing, your normal activities, but offer a part of that to God, and, you know, don't be obsessed with the results. There's not much focus on God. The focus is more on your karma. Okay.
Yeah.
Then you have this Gyan Yoga is there, okay?
Yeah.
That's like the next level where you renounce everything, most of the things, and you don't renounce completely, but you renounce being too materialistic, and you try to read the Upanishads primarily. That's what Gyan Yoga is in a sense. Yeah. The Karma Yoga is under the domain of the Vedas. Like,
yes.
If you worship Shiva, you get a good wife. If you worship Parvati, you get a good husband, something like that. So it's materially motivated, but
yes,
it is dharmic, and it is under the sanctuary of the Vedas, which means you have to accept there is some authority. That is what the Vedas is, right?
Absolutely.
Either whichever devata it is. So, and then they take you a bit towards attachment, but in a dharmic way, in a systematic way, right?
Yeah.
Not like the way it is today, you know, people are just doing anything, anything. Then we go to Gyan Yoga, which is like renouncing materialistic pleasure and then going more towards the detachment side.
Yeah.
And then reading the Upanishads, you know, like four Vedas and 108 Upanishads are there.
Yeah.
So in the Upanishads, there is a lot of condemnation about family life, you know, sex life, money, children. It's all just, you know, detached and, you know, stay away from all that. And then we also have Ashtanga Yoga later on. Ashtanga Yoga is like trying to ultimately focus on the 400 Vishnu form, which is there inside your heart, like Yama, Niyama, all these, like the final stage is Samadhi, of course.
Yes.
Like when you are finally focusing on the 400 Vishnu form, which you have to see in the first place to do that. And once these three levels are over, then we go to the next stage, which is actually Bhakti Yoga. So Bhakti Yoga means you treat God as if he's like a normal person who has, you know, emotions, and you have a relationship with that person.
Yeah.
And that is what Krishna says at the end of the Bhagavad Gita. He says, you know, Bhakti Maim Karam Param Kritva, he says, Yoginam api sarvesham madgate nantaratmana shraddhavan bhajate yomam samaye yuktatamo mataha. One who is always thinking of me, he's the topmost yogi, right?
Yeah.
And when can you think of anybody? Whenever a man is obsessed with a girl, he's always thinking of
the girl. Yeah.
A pair, a mother or father, newly born child.
Always thinking of the child. Yeah.
Yes. So whoever you are attached to, you will be thinking of that person 24 hours. Yeah. Maybe even in your dreams also, right?
We are thinking of Jyotish all the time. Yeah. Yesterday, I was telling someone in the dream about his Surya being here, this big man. Said, my wife said, what are you doing? I said, no, I was in a consultation. He said, God damn it, you're sleeping.
Yeah, that's what Krishna says, that... You think of me all the time, and you do the spiritual practices which in the scriptures advise, like, you know, chanting of God's names, then reading of Bhagavad Gita, Srimad Bhagavatam, and so many things. So we see this moon is representing an element of emotions and Bhakti Yoga, which is very prominently linked with the third house.
Yes.
And as you beautifully explained, moon is also the seventh lord, right?
Yeah.
So seventh house always shows exit. In fact, when somebody passes away, they leave this world.
Yeah.
You know, when you draw that chart that time when the person leaves the body, planets in the seventh house can give you clues about what is the person's next life going to be like. Okay.
Yeah.
So therefore, Prabhupada always used to stress on this fact that this world that you are living in is a temporary place. It doesn't mean this is not existing or this is not useful, but there are a lot of limitations in this material realm. So you need to go back to the spiritual world from where we have come. So his books are primarily focused on this point, that we cannot be happy in this material world for a very long time. And even if we are, then we'll still be unhappy at the end, because we have to leave everything, right?
And
you should live in such a way that you don't have to take birth again, right? So perfect your life. And at the end of your life, you can think of God and go back to the spiritual world. As Krishna says, you know, anta kale cha mameva smaran muktva kalevam, that whatever we think of at the time of our death, that destination we attain. Okay.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So that's very clear when you see his third house. So that this Ashtakvagar will tell you why is he writing these books at all, right?
Yeah.
Of course, you can always see 10th house is there, 11th house is there, the books become famous or viral. That's another issue, because many times whenever we talk of Ashtakvagar, people say, bo, so you mean this will make me famous? I'll become popular because of this? No, it's not that.
Yeah.
That is dependent on your karma. You may become famous or not, but the question is, why are you writing those books in the first place? So that was his agenda, you see.
Yeah. And that was the 7th house association, you know, with the 5th house, and that moon giving 8 in the 3rd, you know, that is, that's a clear picture. And you know what, you just said beautifully, you know, one thing that, you know, the 7th house, the planets in the 7th house at the time of the death, you know, at the time of the death, that the kundli we make is a prashna, you know, that's the kundli is called the prashna. And the 7th house of the prashna is actually the 12th from the 8th. Okay, so this is where your soul is going to leave an impression that this is where I'm going now.
Okay.
You know, because it is 12th from your 8th house. Right. And, you know, if you look at, you know, his, 12th from the 8th house, I mean, obviously it has got, you know, 31 scores here in the Ashtakvarga. That means that his association with the Krishna during the birth, not in the death, you know, it's going to be extremely powerful. It's a very respectable Samudaya Ashtakvarga, because all the planets are contributing. When I say all the planets are contributing, I want to share one more observation. There's another method that I look at, you know, when I see the momentum of the horoscope. You see, including the ascendant, you know, his all the planets are, you know, either, you know, there are two Surya Nakshatras, okay, one and another here, which is Uttar Shada and Uttar Falguni, right? There are two Moon Nakshatras, there are two Mars Nakshatras, two Ketu Nakshatras, and a Jupiter and a Venus Nakshatra. That's his field, you know, that's the cultivation field of his life. Right, where he has bored the, or he sowed the, you know, seeds of his karma, the previous karma. Now moon will pull over this his field. And you see, there are three planets or three nakshatras, right, where there's no place in his field. Like there is none Buddha nakshatra, there is none Rahu nakshatra, and there is none Saturn nakshatra. You see? There's no Saturn nakshatra in the total nakshatras. There's none Rahu nakshatra and there's none Mercury nakshatra. So when, you know, you don't have any of these nakshatras, what happened to these planets? You know, what happened to these planets here? All these three, Saturn is exalted, Mercury is in the exaltation, and Rahu is in the own sign. So this is how that his karma from the previous janma, you know, did not assign any nakshatra for these three planets, but then these three planets have gotten exalted. So if they don't have their home-like place, which is their own nakshatra, but then they are fully aware in the exaltation stage. And did you observe one more thing? There is not even a single retrograde planet.
Brilliant.
Not even a single retrograde planet here. Right?
Brilliant.
So that is
confusion, fully clear.
Absolutely clear. Absolutely clear. And one planet got depleted, which is finally making a Neech Bhang. Right? So if we don't tell someone that this is chart of the Srila Prabhupada, you will see 10,000 negative comments on this chart.
And this is quite interesting because like he had said many times that his father, you know, Gaur Mohandey, he was a pure person. Like he was a pure devotee of Lord Krishna. And there was a time when in the childhood, Prabhupada fell sick very badly. And in fact, when Prabhupada was born, when Gaur Mohandey would invite all the sadhus, he would request all the sadhus, please bless that my son will become a great devotee of Srimati Radharani, actually. And there was one time when Prabhupada fell sick and the doctor came and said that you have to take this chicken soup. Okay.
Okay.
And then Gaur Mohandey said, no, we cannot take meat. That's not possible. That is better we die than taking this. Then Prabhupada continued to feel still very sickly. And then so many people had, you know, like convinced Gaur Mohandey or consoled him that, yeah, he's a child. You know, if he doesn't live, if he dies, how will he practice spirituality? So doctor bol raha hai to thoda khila do, you know, just put some
and then chicken. Too, he was in Bengal, you know.
In Bengal, so they say fish is like jaleer phal, it's like food. Then this doctor came with that plate of chicken soup. And Prabhupada was very small. He was like a baby that time, maybe. Then when the doctor brought it near, then Prabhupada just put the plate like this. And then Gaur Mohandey said, he has said he will not take. That's it. Stop it.
Don't force him.
So we see this Venus, which is, you know, the fifth house lord, 10th house lord, is getting Neech Bhanga from Mercury, who is again the ninth lord. So the father is very strongly re-instantiating these ideals. And regarding Venus, like regarding married life also, there was a time when Prabhupada, his married life, he had some problems with his wife sometime. And then he had expressed his desire to marry somebody else, you know, to his father, that I want to marry somebody else. But his father said, no, don't do this. Do not go and marry somebody else just because you don't like your spouse, because this will prove to be a very big blessing later on. Because then if you are not very attached, you can leave it will be easier for you to renounce the world or, you know, take sannyas. And Prabhupada said actually many times that, because he did not have much attachment towards his family, so it was easy for him to renounce. So that debility of Venus, you know, getting Neej Bhanga. So that's the thing. That's the beauty of astrology. Like Ashtagora, even here, you may say, oh, planet is getting Neej Bhanga. And the client will be like, okay, so what do I make out of it, right? You have to be able to explain him like a doctor explains to a patient. Okay, you take this, then after 5 days, you will feel good, okay? So we can't just say, oh, like I see astrologers saying, oh, your Saturn dasha is there, Saturn is in fifth house, you know, very good. And then what's happening in his real life, right? Is he or she getting a children or... getting a child, or, you know, doing some mantra, shastra reading or chanting, or what is the person doing? So here, ninth Lord Mercury is giving Neej Bhanga to Venus. Father will actually help. And the father will help this person to get away from this debility.
Absolutely. And you know what? Another one thing, Babaji ji, the Mercury in the ninth house, right? You know, where else all the Mercury nakshatras are sitting. You know, the remaining Mercury nakshatras, like Mercury is sitting in Hasta. Now, Hasta is a Chandra nakshatra.
Correct.
Okay. Now, the Chandra nakshatra are sitting in the 159. You see, the next nakshatra will be Shravana in the Lagna, and the next nakshatra would be Rohini.
Rohini.
Right? So, if you have the Lagnesh sitting in a nakshatra, and that nakshatra lord is in the exalted sign, okay, you know, your 159 is automatically active from the time of the birth. Because every nakshatra, which is a lordship, like if there's a Mercury nakshatra, or if there's a Moon nakshatra, or there's a Venus nakshatra, they will be always 159 with each other. Always. If you have a Venus nakshatra, all the Venus nakshatras will be 159.
Correct.
If you have Mercury nakshatra, all the Mercury nakshatra will be 159 from each other. If you have Moon nakshatra, it will be 159 from each other. So here, Moon nakshatra is the pure Vishnu's nakshatra, Hasta. Is a pure Vaishnav nakshatra. You know, out of the Shravana and Rohini, I like Hasta the most.
Okay.
To be very honest.
Okay.
Right. And having, you know, your father, you know, kind of a image in the Hasta is phenomenal. It's absolutely phenomenal. And this is where the, you know, the seeds of his bhakti and devotion was sown from the father. From the father. Right? And mother was sitting exactly 9 places from him, taking care.
Yes.
See, look at his D10 chart. Look at the Dishamsha. He's got Saraswati Yoga in the 10th house. That is absolutely phenomenal. And look at his Lagan Lord going in the 8th house. Right? This is again, you know, something which is unimaginable.
Here also in the D10, I see Mars, the Moon, Mars are, you know, in trines to each other.
So. Yes, they're trines to each other.
Correct.
Right. So, I mean, the chart, you know, shows everything that is gone through. And you know what, with Sagittarius, you know, when he left his body in 1977,
correct,
right, November 14th, 1977, correct, right, his Saturn was transiting over his 8th house, mm-hmm, at that time, right, and his Rahu and Ketu, you know, his Rahu was in the 9th house, transiting in the 9th house over his Mercury and Venus. Okay, and Saturn was here. So Saturn was 12th from where Rahu was transiting, which is his Lagna. Okay, and Rahu was 2nd from it, where it was transiting. And Ketu was obviously in the 3rd house, which is 8th from it, the transit. So that is a complete combination of leaving the body, right? And that is where I confirmed, and I was 100% convinced that he belonged to the Capricorn Lagna. Because, you know, leaving his body exactly matched with the chart, the transit. You can take out the transit of 14 November 1977, you will find Saturn transiting here, 100%. Right? So that was also seen. Now, you know, building the ISKCON temples all around the world, right? And you know what? The first temple, I had just data with me. He did ISKCON temple in 1971. Okay? So that was a time when the ISKCON temple was did. I think he incorporated ISKCON in 1966. And ISKCON temple Vrindavan, you know, that he did in 1971. So I can go to 1971. What was he running in 1971? You see, 1971, it was again, you know, Mercury Mahadasha and the Antra of the first 3 months of 1971 was Mercury and then the Ketu. Okay, so the Ketu took over. Now, Mercury, you see again, and then the Saturn. Okay, so Saturn was his Karmasthana, the main Amartya Karak. Now, Amartya Karak is a planet for which, you know, you can rely for the funds, you know. Yeah. So this was a time when he could achieve the funds. You know, this was a time when people started connecting and started donating for ISKCON. The serious donation started from where, you know, from here. And then about the Mayapur, right? And that was, I think, let me check when he did Mayapur was, yes, in 1971, ISKCON Kolkata. That is what he did. And then Mayapur, I'll have to check. When was this? Okay. Grand opening of the temple in Vrindavan happened in 1975. Okay. Mm-hmm. So that was again his Ketu period. You see, 1975 was again Ketu and Jupiter. Right? Clear indication. And 1977 was Saturn, Ketu and Saturn, when he left his body. Now, one more thing. When you leave your body in Ketu Mahadasha, right? This is one of the most auspicious Vimshottari Dashas to leave your body.
Okay, I see.
Right? I mean, that particular moment, you know, if you see that somebody's left body in Ketu, and Ketu in the nakshatra of whom? Ketu sitting in his own nakshatra of Magha.
Correct.
And that too in the 8th house. Right? This is something which is a clear indication that he would have been liberated. There's no doubt about it. I don't have a single doubt about it that he was not liberated. And, you know, one of his, you know, lectures that I was listening, he said that Guru never dies. Every single time he has felt, you know, there was a time when in San Francisco he used to go to a shipyard center, and he used to tell that when is the next ship going back to India, and then he used to come back and sit in his room and say, okay, my Guruji, just hold in my hand and say, Srila, you need to stay some more time here. And from there he said that Gurus are always, even if they left their bodies, even you and I or any human being,
yeah,
we never die. That presence of that biological form and the energy is always there. See, one thing. See, we've done this video today, Babaji Ji. You know, 400 years, 500 years from now, generations are going to watch this and learn Jyotish.
Yes.
We're not going to go.
Very true.
Right. So, I mean, this is the beauty, you know, of his chart. You know, from the Ashtakvargas to the nakshatras to, you know, his dashas and transits. And the most important thing is, one last thing that I want to tell you is how you have great charts, okay, is by looking at the dashas. The maximum time period has gone, you know, the bigger ones is 17 years here and 19 years here, both Saturn and Mercury. They are technically Ati Yog Karak Grahas in his chart. Right? So you say 19 and 17, 36 years of is 80 years of life. Right? And, you know, they've gone wonderfully well. This is where he studied and learned everything. Rahu was okay. Right? This is where his bhakti started. Right? This is where he started manifesting things for himself. You know, this is where, you know, he actually did everything he could do for the 9th house, everything for his guru, and this is where he left, right? I mean, how beautiful it is, you know, to see that your dasha, the flow of that dasha, right? The 36th year, your breaking point, where you are initiated, right? And then eventually you go in the Ketu dasha.
Yes.
This is absolutely amazing. And this is what I all have, you know, on his chart, Abhijit ji.
Thank you so much. It was very nice, not only to discuss the chart, but to interact with you and to read this chart like a normal chart and try to decipher the combinations and placements and dashas, of course, and transits also. I'm very sure, seeing this video, that you would have done a lot of research. And whoever has watched this video, even for 1 minute, or maybe whoever made it till the end, now please thank Navneet ji from the bottom of your heart, because it is not easy to present this kind of work. We may just see it. I'm just seeing it like a spectator. And each one of you are also seeing it. But why are we able to see this? Because this one person who has put in all the time, maybe hundreds of hours of effort to observe the chart, see the dashas, and correlate it with the life events. It is not an easy task, because we as astrologers, we do birth time rectification sometimes, and we know what a pain in the neck that is.
Yeah, it is. And but, you know, before this video, I've done my 16 rounds, you know, of Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. And this is the energy, the aura that I take. And everyone watching this video, right? If you can just start with 4, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. You know, so this 16 word and 32 Akshari, you know, mantra is a Maha Mantra, because every single word is in a Chandas. Chandas is one out of the 6 Shastras that we teach. You know, Jyotish is the Anga, the 6th Anga. And one of the Angas of the Vedas is the Chandas. So this mantra is a complete accurate Chandas. That is why it is Maha Mantra, right? And if you do it, right, the kind of energy, the aura, the knowledge, the divine blessing that you get is absolutely unimaginable, right? Start with 4. Start with 4. You'll be so intoxicated that you'll reach 16, 30, 64, whatnot.
And I forgot to say in the initial part of the introduction, Navneet ji has a very wonderful YouTube channel, and he also does consultations, and he also has courses. So I'll pin all the details down in the description section. So please go and check them out. Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna. Thank you.
See you again soon then.
Sure. Hare Krishna.